This time, one of our current customers has asked us to explain how to use the manual E6B, the flight computer, as in our software, we focus mainly on the electronic flight computer. Because using the manual E6B for the test only guarantees a small chance of getting the right answer. The manual E6B just lacks the precision needed to answer the knowledge test questions, as the answers are just too close to get the right one. But for the sake of being thorough, here is an explanation of the manual E6B. The manual E6B is fairly simple to use. It can do nearly every calculation needed for aviation, like conversions, time, distance, and fuel, wind calculations, etc. And best of all the instructions are found right on the instrument itself. To give you a practical explanation of the functionality of the E6B, let's go through the motions of calculating everything needed for a cross-country flight plan. For example, let's say we've checked the weather and find out that the en route wind is 110 at 20 knots. With our plotter, we found out the true course of 247. And from the performance section of the POH, we found our true airspeed to be 110 knots. And finally, from the chart, we noticed a variation of 7 degrees east. Let's go ahead and see how to determine the magnetic heading and ground speed. As I already said, all the information required to solve the calculations is on the various legends found directly on the E6B itself. Before we even start, the first thing I like to do is to set the center of the plotter on the 100 line. This is not necessary, but it does make it easier for the calculations we are about to undertake. That done, let's follow the instructions on the legend. 1. Place the wind direction of 110 under the true index. Next, we mark the wind velocity of 20 knots up from the center. By the way, this is the main reason for placing the center of the plotter on 100, as now all we need to do is place the mark on 120. Still following the legend, we move to step 3 and place the true course of 247 under the true index. As per step 4, we will slide the wind velocity mark we placed earlier to the task line, the true airspeed line of 110 knots. And finally, we can read our ground speed of 126 knots under the center and read the wind correction angle of about 8 degrees left, which again, looking at the legend, has to be subtracted from our true course of 247 because L, or left, has a minus in front. Therefore, our true heading will be 237. And finally, our magnetic heading will be 230, as east shows a minus once again, meaning we need to subtract 7 from our true heading, for, again, a final magnetic heading of 230. Now let's continue with our cross-country flight plan calculations. The next thing we should probably calculate is the time en route, which is based on the ground speed of 126 knots we found earlier, and the total distance that we would have calculated from the en route chart. Let's say the total distance came out to be about 156 nautical miles, and let's also calculate a couple of legs for practice, one of 14 nautical miles and another of 21 nautical miles. For the rest of the calculations, we will want to turn the E6B to its other side, and as usual, all we need to do is follow the legends on it. As you can see, for the time calculations, we need to set the big triangle marker over the ground speed, then look for the distance on the outer ring, and find the time on the inner rings. So, if we set the speed on 126 knots, and then we look for a distance of 156 nautical miles, we can see on the middle circle a time of 74, which is in minutes, or the inner circle a time of 1 hour and 14 minutes, which is exactly 74 minutes. Now, if we look for the time it would take to travel 14 nautical miles, we can see about 67 on the middle circle and about 1 hour and 7 minutes on the inner circle. It is fairly obvious that if we are traveling at 126 knot, it will take 1 hour to travel 126 nautical miles. So the answer we just found doesn't make any sense. Or do they? Well, all the numbers on the dials can also represent the decimal of that number, or that number in hundreds or thousands. What I mean is that the 67 we found could be 0.00007 or 67 million, and it is up to us to make sense of them. If our speed is 126 knots, we are traveling just over 2 miles per minute, because flying at 60 knots means we travel 60 miles in 60 minutes, 1 hour, or 1 nautical mile per minute. So 120 knots means 2 miles per minute. And at 126, it's just a little above that. So if the distance was 12 nautical miles, it would take us just under 6 minutes to travel there. 1/10 of an hour, as 12 is 1/10 of 120. So again, in this case here, the correct answer is 6.7 minutes, which you should round to about 7 minutes. It's always better to round up rather than round down. First, for safety. Considering the worst-case scenario will always keep you ahead of the game. And second, the airplane you're flying is probably not a brand new one, and the performance of it is probably going to be a little worse than what the POH shows. Finally, following the same principle for the distance of 21, we can see an answer of about 10 minutes. Next is the fuel calculation, and let's say that from the pilot operating handbook, we find that our fuel consumption is 9.7 gallons per hour. Again, all you need to do is read the legend to see that you need to place the big triangle marker on the gallons per hour. And this time we will start from the inner ring, where we have time in hours on the inner ring and the time in minutes on the middle ring. And then read the fuel consumption on the outer ring. So again, given our data, we set the marker on 9.7 gallons per hour, and then look at 1 hour and 14 minutes, or 74 minutes, to get a fuel consumption of about 12 gallons. Remember that 12 could be 1.2 as well as 120. If the time had been 7.4 minutes, the consumption would have been 1.2 gallons. And if the time was 740 minutes, the consumption 120 gallons. On the next slide, let's see some altitude calculations and some conversions. Now, for some altitude calculations and some conversions, let's say you need to calculate the density altitude at 5,000 feet pressure altitude with a temperature of 20 degrees centigrade. Again, we follow the legend, which this time directs us to set the temperature over the pressure altitude on the right window and read the answer under the center density altitude window. So if we set the temperature of plus 20 on the 5,000 feet pressure altitude, we can see that the density altitude is close to 6,000 feet, which does make sense because a higher than standard temperature will return a higher density altitude. As I mentioned earlier, if you are calculating these values for the actual knowledge test, it will be close to impossible to get the correct answer, as the answers are very close to each other and the manual E6P just lacks the precision required to be accurate enough. But if you just need a quick reference of what the number might be, feel free to use it. Now for some conversions. Let's say you need to convert 187 nautical miles into statue miles. All you need to do is to align the statue marker on the middle ring to the nautical marker on the outer ring. Nautical miles are found on the outer ring, 187, and the middle ring reads 215 statue miles. One more conversion, let's convert 122 liters into gallons. And for that, we will align the liters marker on the middle ring with the US gallon marker on the outer. Look for 122 on the middle ring, where the liters are found, and find it matching 32.5 gallons on the outer one.